Hey guys, TommyBryson here, and in life, we have something called a black swan. An event that's actually very unpredictable and is very rare to actually happen. Now, for example, in this video, the whole idea is basically, well, Tommy, if I invest money with a broker, for example, like Schwab's Fidelity, M1 Finance, Robinhood, Acorns, what would happen, for example, if that broker goes bankrupt? What happens to my cash, my investments, my Bitcoin? Where does all my money go? Now, the likelihood of that happening is very low. However, is it impossible? The answer is no. It happened a while back, for example, in 1960s, 1990s, and also, for example, as recently as in 2008. So although it is a black swan, it does not mean it's impossible that it might happen. So the goal for this video is to say, hey, what can I do as a customer to make sure my money is protected and that way I don't lose it if my broker does something stupid and then boom, they go bankrupt or they're basically on the glimpse of bankruptcy? What happens then? Okay, I'll tell you exactly what to do in this video. Now, if you guys are new here, I post videos every single day. So make sure to also subscribe and hit the bell so you're notified. On top of that, also destroy the like button. And by the way, by the end of this video, I'll tell you exactly the broker I actually use and why I actually use them. Now, the very first thing is this, guys, okay? Yes, it is very possible for a broker to go bankrupt, but the rules have changed a lot and basically our benefit as a customer, as a consumer, as the investor. Now, why? Because basically, in the 1960s, when brokers went bankrupt, guess what? You had to go ahead and sue them. So basically, grab your money, get a lawyer, and try to sue your broker to get your money back and your assets back. And by the way, back then, it was very difficult because basically, they used to grab your money, okay, and their money, mix it together, and if they had debt, they would use that money to go ahead and pay off whatever debt they actually had, because guess what, they were gonna go bankrupt. And on top of that, the record keeping was not that great because back then we didn't have that much tech. However, moving forward, 1990, you have, for example, Drexel and Burnham, right? And the whole idea is that this broker was also going bankrupt, but guess what happened? The SIPC was actually intact, in play. And by the way, the SIPC is going to be your favorite word in this whole video because basically, these are the people that are actually going to protect you when the broker actually goes bankrupt. Now, the idea is that when that company went bankrupt in 1990, guess what happened? They had to go ahead and self-liquidate, meaning we don't got no money, no one's gonna buy us, we're gonna self-liquidate. Now, the cool thing is basically, the money has to be kept separate when you're a part of the SIPC, meaning that, hey, my investment money is separate and your money as a broker is separate. So when you go self-liquidate, my money should be there. So the idea is that the SIPC stepped in and basically were able to transfer over those assets and those cash over to another account. That way the investor was safe and no problem actually happened. And on top of that, guys, in 2008, when the whole financial calamity happened, okay, you also had companies going bankrupt, but one is called Bear and Stern, right? And the idea is that, guess what? They didn't have to self-liquidate because basically they found a buyer. That buyer was Chase, which made the whole process a lot more smoother. But the point of me saying all of this is this, guys, okay? A black swan event is very rare to happen, but it can happen. And when it does happen, you wanna make sure, hey, I'm safe, I'm good, I'm okay. So that's why I tell you, okay? It's important to know what happens in history. That way, you know how to protect yourself today. In 2001, okay? Now, Tommy, all right, I get it, okay? However, what would happen in 2021 if anything actually happened with my broker and they actually went bankrupt, okay? What would happen to my money? Well, the first thing is basically, you wanna make sure your broker is under the SIPC. That way, you're actually protected, okay? That's the whole idea. Kind of like when a bank is FDIC insured, it gives you confidence. The same thing should be happening with the SIPC, which, by the way, stands for Security Investor Protection Act, which was established by Congress in order to bring back confidence. That way, you don't have to worry that much, okay? Now, the whole idea is basically, it's kind of like insurance for the broker to make sure they can actually go ahead and cover if anything actually happens with your money. And by the way, again, the broker has to keep their money separate from yours. And on top of that, they have to keep a certain level of money liquid. That way, if they go bankrupt, something actually happens, they actually have money there to actually cover things, okay? Now, the whole idea is this, Tommy. What does the SIPC actually cover and how does it actually work? The idea is they cover up to 500K in securities and also cash, but no more than 250K in cash. So basically, if you have 300K in cash, they'll cover up to $250,000 and the rest in securities. That's the way it works. Now, securities, I mean, for example, stocks, bonds, mutual funds, and so on, right? But it does not include, by the way, cryptocurrency or Bitcoin and all that stuff. So be very careful when you're investing into those things, because basically, if something happens, you're not actually protected under the law. So keep that in mind, all right? Now, again, if I invest $500,000, okay, I can go ahead and get that money back under the SIPC. If I have, for example, $250 in investments and $250, for example, in cash with that broker, I can get all my money back, right? Now, if I have too much money inside there, what happens is very simple, and I'll tell you about it later on in the video. However, overall, there are two scenarios that happen whenever a broker goes bankrupt. Scenario A is simple and fast. The brokers have got to go bankrupt, so someone else steps in, buys them out, and everything stays the same. That way, you're good to go a lot fast, right? However, if that doesn't happen, they have to go ahead and self-liquidate. For example, like the 1990, like example I gave you. And when that happens, they have to go ahead and basically, the SIPC steps in with the court also, make sure all the investments are actually there, and goes ahead and distributes them accordingly to who actually owes them and so on, according to the 500K policy. That's the idea. However, the process is very simple, okay? Overall, process is this, guys, okay? It's just basically six steps, okay? Step one is going to be, hey, they have to build the claim form. Once the claim is actually in stack, you, the customer, have to go ahead and basically go to the SIP website and basically go ahead and say, hey, I'm a claimant. Let me file this claim. Everything's done online, by the way. Once taken care of, they have to go ahead and say, hey, we're going to review your claim and either accept it or not accept it, depending on what's actually going on. Once it's taken care of, they pay out the money to you. Now, if you went overboard and you have too much money invested, the idea is they can go ahead and also pay that money out if there's money in the account. And that's what things are complicated, okay? Now, on top of that, okay, guess what? This, although it's simple, it does take a while. It can take months and sometimes a few years to actually get this money out to you. Now, the bad thing is this. Although your money is protected, guess what happens, okay? If, say, for example, while you're waiting to get your assets back and also your money back, guess what? If your assets went down, for example, in value, your stocks plummeted down, they do not care. They're going to pay it according to what it's worth, okay? So if it went down, it's not their fault, it's not their business, and that's what's gonna happen. That's what's usually, the best idea is basically when the company sells out, then you actually go ahead and transfer your investments over to another company. Now, by the way, usually they do give you a warning to give you the chance to go ahead and transfer the investments over to another company. That way, you don't have to go through this whole process, but sometimes it happens all of a sudden, then you have to be in trouble and that's gonna be a problem, okay? Now, overall, to protect yourself, what you wanna do is these three things right here. The first thing is make sure the broker you're with is actually under the SIPC, okay? That way you're basically protected up to 500K. On top of that, actually basically, they actually have additional insurance. That way, if it doesn't cover all of your money, it can cover potentially even more, depending if they actually have supplemental insurance. On top of that, thirdly, guys, you want to make sure you keep basically a record of your statements. That way, if anything happens, you can go ahead and say, hey, here's proof that I actually own these investments. Because the whole goal is basically, by the way, remember the whole Madoff situation? People had to prove they own those investments. And that was actually very hard because basically Madoff had, for example, a bunch of falsified documentations, which made it a lot harder for the SIPC to verify everything. So that's why it's so important you keep also your own records. If anything happens, you'll be more protected. But overall, guys, the way I do it and stay protected is like this, okay? I use M1 Finance, which, by the way, has a checking account and also a brokerage account, okay? And the idea is by doing this, guess what happens, okay? I have money that's protected by the FDIC, means up to $250,000 protected. Also, with my broker, also in finance, by the way, also protected up to 500K. On top of that, Apex, the clearing company, actually has supplemental insurance to cover me even further if the entire SIPC funds actually get exhausted. Now, overall, I don't know exactly to what point, because basically, I read online and it said basically, hey, we just have, for example, supplemental insurance. That's all it says. We don't know exactly how much money is actually in it, right? We don't know that. However, I did read an article right here. Well, not an article, like more like a post or whatever that says basically They covered up to $2 million. However, though, I don't trust it because basically this person is wrong about the 100K because basically it's actually 250K in cash is actually covered by the SIPC. So overall, what I like to do is basically I have M1 Finance. So that way I'm covered from multiple fronts. But in order to find out exactly what supplemental insurance actually is, I'm gonna have to go ahead and call in and ask, hey, up to what amount am I covered with the supplemental insurance? And that way I can find out exactly what the whole idea is. But overall, make sure your broker is a part of the SIPC. Make sure also you can get basic supplemental insurance that they actually have that. And also keep, for example, some detailed statements that way if anything happens, you're covered. Again, the odds of this happening are very low. But if it does happen, this way you're also protected and you don't have to worry about it. That's the overall idea of this video right here, guys. But guys, comment down below and comment basically, I got it or I don't get it. That way I know if you got this whole idea or if you didn't get the whole idea. And that way I can break it down for you also in the comments down below. On top of that, like and subscribe to this channel, guys. That way I know you actually like these videos. On top of that, also I have other channels. You can actually call me one-on-one. Click the link down below for that channel right there. You can actually call me. I'll actually answer. Free calls, by the way. All calls are free. Links down below. And also follow me on Instagram, TommyBryson. And before I go, guys, thanks for watching this video. And as always, peace.